When she glanced ahead her first thought was to take in the points of Kells's horse. She had been used to horses all her life. Kells rode a big, rangy bay, a horse that appeared to snort speed and endurance. Her pony could never run away from that big brute. Still, Joan had the temper to make an attempt to escape, if a favorable way presented. The morning was rosy, clear, cool. There was a sweet, dry tang in the air. White-tailed deer bounded out of the open spaces, and the gray-domed, glistening mountains, with their bold, black-fringed slopes, overshadowed the close foothills. Joan was a victim to swift vagaries of thought and conflicting emotions. She was riding away with a freebooter, a road agent, to be held for ransom. The fact was scarcely credible. She could not shake the dread of nameless peril. She tried not to recall Robert's words, yet they haunted her. If she had not been so handsome, he had said, Joan knew she possessed good looks, but they had never caused her any particular concern. That Kells had let them influence him, as Robert had imagined, was more than absurd. Kells had scarcely looked at her. It was gold such men wanted. She wondered what her ransom would be, where her uncle would get it, and if there really was a likelihood of that rich strike. Then she remembered her mother, who had died when she was a little girl, and a strange, sweet sadness abided with her. It passed. She saw her uncle, that great, robust, hearty, splendid old man, with his laugh and his kindness and his love for her, and his everlasting, unquenchable belief that soon he would make a rich gold strike. What a roar and a stampede he would raise at her loss. The village camp might be divided on that score, she thought, because the few young women in that little settlement hated her, and the young men would have more peace without her.